Hello guys, today we're back with another audiobook, and today we're gonna do Took, the Next Chapter by Mary Downing Hahn, and it's a ghost story. So apparently chapter 4, which is the chapter we're gonna do in this video, is long, so we're gonna split it up into part 1 and part 2 in different videos. So let's see. After dinner that night, Erica told Mom and Dad about the boy on the bus and what he told us. Our parents agreed with me. This was an old, old farm, and no one had lived in this house for a long time. It was exactly the sort of place that inspired people to make up stories. It must be a country version of an urban legend, Dad said. Like the man with the... Mom stopped them with a sharp look. The man with the what? Erica said. The man with the monkey, I said to rescue Dad. I definitely didn't want him telling Erica about the man with the hook. In fact, I myself didn't want to hear that story. Not here. Not at night, when anything could be out there howling in the dark. Watching us through the tall living room windows, Mom hadn't gotten around to covering with the curtains. Does the monkey disappear? Erica persisted. Of course not, I told her. He and the man run away from the circus and live happily ever after in a tar paper shack. Erica laughed. And they eat wild berries for breakfast, lunch, and dinner? Dad winked at me. Exactly. Erica snuggled beside Mom on the couch and listened to a chapter of The Mopats, a book Mom loved when she was Erica's age and still did. When it was time for bed, Erica said, I don't want to go upstairs. It's so dark outside my window. Daniel's right across the hall from you, Mom said. And Dad and I are in the next room. Will you come with me, Mommy? Erica said. Asked and tucked me in and sit with me till I fall asleep. Dad asked, give in now, Martha. It'll be the same every night. Either Mom didn't hear him or she ignored him. Scooping Erica up as if she was still a baby, she carried her upstairs. Dad shook his head. Your mother is spoiling that child. I shrugged, opened my odious social studies book and began memorizing the imports, exports, and the native products of Germany. What a waste of time Woodville School was. My textbook had been published 30 years ago. When I paused Erica's door later, I heard my sister say, Are you sure it's just a legend? Yes, Mom said. Please stop worrying about it. No one disappeared. A girl named Celine never lived here. That boy was a liar. Next morning, Erica and I sat in front of the school bus right behind Miss Plummer. The bus slowed for a second stop and Brody got on. Erica stared out the window pretending not to see him, but I gave him a dirty look. He made an ugly face, sat down behind us, and began kicking the back of my seat. As the bus filled with kids, Brody told them where Erica and I lived. One girl said she never walked down the road past our driveway. Her friend claims that her big sister and some of her friends drove up the driveway on a dare. It was a few years ago when no one lived on the house. They heard people crying and wailing and calling Celine's name. They didn't see nothing, but they got out of there fast. Echo pressed her fingers and her ears and hummed. But I listened to every word. If I was dumb enough to believe their stories, a family named Estes lived on the farm about 40 or 50 years ago, maybe even more. No one was sure. It was before they were born, but their parents or maybe their grandparents remembered it. They had a daughter named Celine, and she disappeared when the girl was 7 years old, and no one ever found her. One girl said she was took. Maybe it was the demons in the wood, a boy suggested. Maybe old auntie, the conjure woman up on Brewster's Hill, got her, Brody said. Or worst of all, a girl said, old auntie's razorback hog, the one called Bloody Bones, ate her up. Nobody agreed about who took Celine, but they all agreed that she was never found. By the time we arrived at school, Erica was trembling. We waited until the bus was empty and then got off to leave. Miss Plummer stopped Erica. Don't let them scare you, she told my sister. It's just a yarn people have been spinning for years. Not a speck of truth in them. A girl named Celine disappeared, but she wasn't took. There's no conjure woman and no bloody bones. She rummaged in her purse and pulled out a pack of lifesavers and handed it to Erica. Help yourself. You too. We each took one and thanked her. They're not really bad kids, Miss Plummer said. Just nobody taught them manners. They've grown up as wild as bears in the woods. Give them time. They'll get friendly when they're used to you. A week passed, then another week followed. But those kids didn't get used to Erica and me. They didn't even try. Luckily, Miss Plummer saved the seat behind her for us, so nobody could say or do anything to us without getting kicked off the bus. Even so, they found ways to torment us with stories of Celine Estes, a whisper here, a comment there, a note or a drawing passed to us. When we were off the bus, with no Miss Plummer to protect us, the boys continued to knock me around on the playground and the girls whispered about Erica. Unlike Miss Plummer, our teachers never noticed, or maybe they didn't care. Mom and Dad didn't have any more luck in Woodville than we did. The adults disliked them for the same reason the kids disliked Erica and me. They were especially offended by our failure to join the only church in town. We weren't only outsiders. We were godless outsiders. As far as jobs went, neither Dad nor Mom found a position in Woodville. Not that there was much to choose from. Dad finally got a job at Home Depot where he wore a big orange apron and helped people find tools, paint, garbage cans, plumbing supplies, and whatever else they were looking for, most often the restrooms. Soon after, Mom landed a position as a receptionist at the real estate office on the other side of the parking lot from the Home Depot. Nobody there cared where my parents came from or if they went to church. The people who worked at the shopping center were practically all outsiders themselves. From cities such as Charleston and Woodville, they claimed, you'd never be accepted if you weren't married to your cousin. Dad laughed at this, but Mom said it was an ignorant way to talk. On weekends, Dad and I got into the habit of spending our free time roaming the woods and fields, following trails made long ago by trappers and hunters. He was forever stopping to take a picture of a lichen-covered boulder or a mossy log, a tangle of branches, a gnarled tree, a hawk or a crow in flight, but I didn't mind. I loved being in the woods with him. Neither Mom nor Erica went with us. Mom had too much to do, she said, and Erica had no interest in the great outdoors. While Mom busied herself weaving, Erica sat nearby rereading the Little House on the Prairie books or playing with little Erica. Sometimes she drew pictures or stories in her sketch pads. Sometimes she painted with watercolors. She seemed perfectly content until the day ended. When night came, she grew fearful and clung to Mom. She still spoke of hearing scary whispers in the dark corners of her room. On this particular day, a Saturday, Mom was working at the realtor's office. If you want to hear more of Took Mary Downing Han, a ghost story, please leave a like and a subscribe button down below. Make sure to see part 2 in the next episode. Goodbye! Oh, one other thing. Hit the notification bell if you don't know what that is. It's basically a button where you press and you'll get notified about all the times that I upload a video and you get to watch them. So, goodbye!